Good morning. My name is Robin Maxwell Nunn, and I'm your presider this morning. Welcome to the folks joining us online from both Trinity and Forest Hill United, and to all of you here at the Nest. Before we go any further, we have some announcements. First, we'll hear from a group about the guess who's coming to dinner.
I'm good, okay. Good morning. So prepare for a little humor. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
A herd.
A herd what?
A herd you were invited, so I invited myself over.
Awesome.
I messed that one up already.
I know I did.
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Wooden shoe.
Wooden shoe who?
Wouldn't you like to hear another joke?
Oh, of course.
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Guess.
Guess who?
Guess who's coming to dinner, that's who.
I'll just
For those of you new to the activity, it's a two-part social event, so both singles and couples are welcome to participate. The first part is the host, and that person creates dinner for the guests. The second part are the guests, and you go to a host's house for your dinner. You also prepare a dessert for a potluck dessert that's held back at the church following the dinner. The surprise part comes when you don't know whose house you're going to. So a week before the event, one of the committee members, Sue Hummel's one of our committee members as well, will give you a phone call with either an address for if you're a guest, or if you're a host, you'll find out how many people are coming to your house for dinner. So that's the fun part. That's the fun part. Sign-ups will start next Sunday, just before church and after church in the foyer. So please do participate and remember the date of April 27th. Thanks.
And now Rob Steele will talk to us about the annual general meeting.
Thanks, Robin. Just a reminder that annual general meeting for Forest Hill folks, part three, will be on Sunday, April 7th, so 2 weeks from today, immediately following worship. The finance team will answer all your questions about the 2024 budget that was already presented, and we will entertain a motion to approve that budget as well. So looking forward to seeing everybody out. Thank you.
Please join us for Good Friday service at Calvary United Church. There will be a brunch at 9 a.m., followed by the 10 a.m. service. This service is jointly held with Calvary, St. James Rosemount, and members of the Nest. Our Easter Sunday communion service is at 10 a.m. Please come and join us as we roll away the stone. And now let us hear our land acknowledgement. We acknowledge that we gather on the traditional territories subject to land and treaty claims of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and the Chonantan or Attawandaron peoples. We acknowledge our participation in the climate crisis and its effect on Indigenous people around the world because of their close relationship with the land and its resources. We seek reconciliation in all forms. This morning is Palm Sunday, and so to recreate a small taste of that great day of celebration, we ask the kids to please come forward and join Reverend Gary at the front.
Good morning. Am I on? Does it sound like I'm on? No? One, two, three. One. Oh, there we are. Woo! Well, good morning. I have a question for you this morning. How many coats do you think you own? How many coats do you think? One?
Yeah. Three.
Three?
Yeah.
Three? Two?
Three,
four,
jacket.
Two?
Three, including my rain jacket.
Three, including your rain jacket? So you got a some. Eight? You're my kind of gal. What's that?
They're palm leaves.
That's right, they're palm leaves, that's right. The reason I ask about how many coats you have is that on Palm Sunday, the scripture says that many people put their coats down in front of Jesus. But you know, some people were so poor, they didn't have a coat. And because they didn't have a coat, they thought, oh, how are we going to celebrate that we appreciate Jesus coming into our town and into our lives?
And waving palm leaves.
Right. And so they went and they got palm leaves. So let's get some palm leaves. Just grab a palm leaf.
Can I grab two?
Sure. Let's try these big ones first. Let's try the first. You big palm trees in the Dominican?
Bigger than these ones, and I talked to my daddy with them.
Oh, you did? Well, that's pretty, you know, this would make a pretty good palm tree if it was just about us.
If it just had a coconut.
Oh. But do you think that Palm Sunday is just about us, just the you kids up here?
No.
No. We need to have a bigger party. I think you should try and give some of these palm branches away to the people in this choir or the people in the congregation. Help get them out.
Can we give them out?
Yeah, give them out. Yeah, hand them out. Yeah, some up there. So look at these. All these people here look like they're hungry for a palm branch. Hungry. Do you want to hand that one out there? Hand out the palm branch to the adults. There we go. Look, there's hungry people over there for palm branches and hungry people over there for palm branches. Okay, you're supposed to take one of these things and then you could make more by, there we go. Here's one.
Oh. There's one. Should have chopped this edge off. Whoa, look at that. There's some palm branches. There's some palm branches to separate here. Oh, yeah. These are not, yeah, they look like bamboo, but they're palms. Yeah, you separate them out. Just separate them out. Yeah, okay. Oh, yeah. Do you want to hand those out some? Let's hand these out. Any more hungry for palms out there? Oh, by the way, at the back, there's somebody waving. All right. There's some more. There you go. Hand those out. What's that? Yeah, you better hold on to those. Yeah. Hold on. Okay. Now, so there's some more. You don't know unless you ask, isn't that right? All right. So you want you to hold on to these. Hold on. We're gonna hold on to that and hold on to this one because we're gonna start our palm parade pretty soon. Any palm wavers left? Oh, they're still distributing back there in the back. That's good. Come on up, kids. You are tougher than you look, you know, they think. There we go. Okay, hold on to the palms because now with the adults who've got palms, we won't look askance at those who don't have palms, but we're going to sing the song, Hosanna Loud, Hosanna. We're going to march around the church as we're singing, and then we're going to march out to Sunday school this morning, okay? So who needs a palm? Who needs some palm? We got a palm still? Okay. Okay, here's another one there. Are we ready? All right, let's sing Hosanna, loud Hosanna. 1, 2, 3 in the hymn book or on the PowerPoint. Are you ready? Oh.
Where do we go?
Well, where should you go? You lead on, Oliver. Let's go along there, maybe. You ready? Let's go marching. Woo! She got her hands are full. Hands are full of cookie.
Thank you.
As we have moved through this Lenten season, we have been gleaning wisdom from the book study, Lent in Plain Sight. The premise of the study is that we are called to encounter the holy in everyday things. On this final week of Lent, we consider the use of coats as a symbol of our faith journey. We often tell the story of Joseph and his coat of many colors as a happy one, a father's gift to his beloved son. But that gift symbolized a lot of dysfunction in that family dynamic. Dad showing blatant favoritism, Joseph flaunting his gift and his self-aggrandizing dreams in front of his already resentful brothers. Later, they beat him up and sold him into slavery. They put blood on his fancy coat in order to cover up their misdeeds. Contrast that with the crowd that gathered to welcome Jesus into Jerusalem. Their coats were probably not extravagant with any value, but they were may have been the only heavy garment they owned. And yet, they threw them to the ground to be trampled by a donkey. They were so focused on honoring this unlikely king that their coats didn't matter. Were there any in the crowd who held back, hesitant to give the coat off his back, afraid of looking foolish, or possibly losing their garment? As we move into Holy Week, we see many opportunities between choosing between glorifying ourselves or humbling ourselves. We know which Jesus will choose: washing the feet of his disciples, serving bread to his betrayer, declining to defend himself, and accepting a humiliating death. Holy Week asks, which will we choose? This chapter in Lent in Plain Sight asks us how we are anointed and for what work. Let's continue worship with our Lenten grounding music called With My Voice Alone from the United Church Sampler. Please remain seated. There we go. Next slide. Sing for joy, the Master comes.
Riding on a colt, he enters in victory.
If all shouting stopped, the rocks would ring with joy.
There will be some who will not sing or shout.
There will be some who will cling to their fear. Be ready, O Jerusalem, for your King truly is coming. Hosanna in the highest. Amen. Now here's Reverend Gary with the lighting of our prayer candles and the passing of the peace.
Thanks, Robin. We start our candling this morning. Our first candle is for us to remember our brothers and sisters in the United Church in Lucknow. As they continue their faithful following of Jesus and sharing of Jesus' message of peace. Our second candle this morning is our environment candle, which we've just started lighting to remind us of the importance of the environment, the land on which we live and breathe and have our being. Our third candle is a celebratory candle. I'm going to skip that one there first. Because today is our birthday Sunday, and for those who are new to the nest, we try at least once a month to celebrate all the birthdays of the folks in that month. And so we're in the month of March, so who are our March babies? Please stand up, March baby. I know at least one. There we go, some more March babies. There we go. And so we have cake for that, but we also want to celebrate by singing Happy Birthday to our brothers and sisters in March. Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday, dear friends, happy birthday to you. And many more. We also acknowledge that grief has also been in our lives this month. We light this candle remembering Dorothy Ozark, who was a longtime member of the congregation and supporter, and so we grieve her passing for her and her family. Our final candle this morning, as we continue to pray for peace in a war-torn world, peace in the Gaza, peace in Ukraine, and now peace in Russia, who has suffered this week an attack killing hundreds of people at a music venue. These are our prayers this morning. May God add mercy and grace to our words. So we're going to continue our time together by passing the peace, and this morning's peace is Celebrate Hallelujah. And so celebrate, and hallelujah, woo! Sound effects are mine. Okay, so look at somebody and go, and look at somebody else and go, and one last time look at somebody and go, a very involved group. This is good. This is good. And now it's time for our scripture lesson.
That's a tough act to follow. Good morning, my name is Dennis Deckert, and I would like to share a piece of scripture this morning that is used to set the scene for the Palm Sunday celebration. After saying these things, Jesus headed straight up to Jerusalem. When he got near Bethage and Bethany, at the mountain called Olives, he sent off two of his disciples with these instructions: go to the village across from you. As soon as you enter, you'll find a colt tethered, one that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says anything, ask, what are you doing? Say, his master needs him. Today's scripture reading is Luke 19, verse 29 to 40. The two left and found it just as he said. As they were untying the colt, its owners said, what are you doing untying the colt? They said, his master needs him. They brought the colt to Jesus. Then, throwing their coats on its back, they helped Jesus get on. As he rode, the people gave him a grand welcome, throwing their coats on the street. Right at the crest, where Mount Olives begins its descent, the whole crowd of disciples burst into enthusiastic praise over all the mighty works they had witnessed. Blessed is he who comes, the King in God's name. All's well in heaven, glory in the high places. Some Pharisees from the crowd told him, teacher, get your disciples under control. But he said, if they kept quiet, the stones would do it for them, shouting praise. Let us thank God for this scripture and ask that it make it wiser in our church celebrations. Amen. And now our nest choir will offer a second scripture alluded to in the introduction for the service.
Let's pray. Gracious God, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of all our hearts, be acceptable in your presence. Amen. This morning we've heard two scriptures that in many ways couldn't be more different, except that they have the mention of a coat or coats as a common element. But they're very different. In the scripture that we heard sung just now, it refers, of course, to Joseph and the technicolor dream coat that he is given by his father, a sign of favoritism on this, the youngest son, when there was all these other children, sons mostly. Joseph was brash and bold and brilliant and beautiful, and he knew it. He even was a dreamer and an interpreter of dreams, and one day in his arrogance said to his older siblings, I can point at you, I'm sure, and say, you know, one day you will all bow down to me. They hated him. And they hatched a plot to kill him. And at the last minute, one of the brothers convinced the others not to kill him, but rather to sell him into slavery, reasoning, we'll get rid of him and make a tidy profit off the brat. And that's what they did. And then they took the coat, this symbol of favoritism, and they ripped it and they dipped it in blood to hide the lie that he was dead. Now, the second scripture, which Dennis shared this morning, was of Jesus. And it's pretty clear that Jesus had a very good understanding of how he wanted to enter into Jerusalem, a day that celebrates a new kind of king, and he wanted to come in as the most humble person possible. And so he arranges that a colt, not even a full-grown beast of burden, whether it be a donkey or a horse, but a colt is used, because Jesus wants to be as humble as possible, in creating a new image of kingship. And it's his disciples who, one or two of them, throw their coats on this beast so that Jesus would not have to endure the humiliation of entering into Jerusalem bareback. And the other disciples, seeing this, also want to give honor to Jesus, and so they take off what would be the only thing they owned, practically, to throw it in front of Jesus and his humble mount. So now there are in these two scriptures some very obvious lessons and some subtle or unobvious lessons. In Joseph, the obvious lesson is that when you lift yourself up, no matter how gifted you are, how talented you are likely to be torn down by people within your own family, people who know you best, know your flaws, as well as your shining colored coat. Whereas Jesus shows that the more humble you make yourself, that those who know you best, who know your gifts, will hold you up. The very same people, your family, are going to hold you up and praise you. It seems to be the obvious lesson. But there's a lot of lessons taught that can go below the radar, below our consciousness. And I think one of the lessons that we are taught, and this is held up in the Lenten study, is that all of us wear coats that our parents have given us. And for the most part, we're hardly even aware of the coat that we wear, that we've inherited, of cultural perspective, and often of privilege. And we are equally unaware that wearing that coat means that we will, without any awareness at all, hurt others who have not been given as good a coat. Now, we all have experiences that
This past week, our parliament passed a motion for peace, a calling for a ceasefire in the land, in Gaza. Ceasefire, the return of humanitarian aid so desperately needed, and a call to stop selling weapons of war, particularly to Israel, in this time. We got to stop it. Now, those who voted against the motion said, well, they voted because they saw it as a reward to Hamas, encouraging terrorism. And I thought, if you step back and look at this and say, well, there's been over 30,000 people, over 13,000 of which have been children, have been killed already in Gaza. And almost the whole population of Gaza are at stage 5 of starvation, and there is no stage 6 except death. How is that a reward? And if you were to look at these statistics and say, when is it enough punishment for October 7th? When will vengeance be sated and satisfied? I mentioned last week that I had been on a peace pilgrimage with a number of people, and at the end of the pilgrimage, we had a meal, we shared a meal together, and I fell into conversation, as I am wont to do with total strangers, I'm sure to their chagrin. And I started talking to this young fella who was a vice principal at a local school, not Dan. Anyway, so this guy started talking about his father, and his father was a professor at the American University in Jerusalem. And in the latter part of his working career, ending in 2017, so we're talking very recent, 2017, he got hired on as a non-military observer for the UN in the occupied territories. And let's be clear, they're called the occupied territories because it's land ceded to the Palestinians in 1947 and have been illegally occupied for 50 years. Illegally. The world acknowledges. Not supposed to be there. Israel's not supposed to be there. Anyway, his job was to live in a Palestinian village, and when trouble brewed up, he was to observe and document. That was his job. He said, unfortunately, the Sun was reporting, unfortunately, it was often Israeli settlers causing trouble. So he would go out, he had a prepared script, he would say, Shalom, my name is, because he was fluent in Hebrew, Shalom, my name is, I am a non-military observer for the UN. My job is to observe, to document, and to report to both the government of Israel and to the UN what you have done. And so he observed Israeli settlers poisoning Palestinian wells. He observed the destruction of ancient Palestinian olive groves, often supported by Israeli government forces. He observed the burning of barns, Palestinian barns, and other agricultural equipment. Now, I say this because everybody knows October the 7th, the attack was horrendous and unwarranted, but it did not occur in a vacuum. 50 years of an inability to address injustice. Injustice that went largely unpunished. And so we have today vengeance, a thirst for vengeance on both sides. Only a dream of peace. In this passage, we are reminded that it is the siblings who need to step in and tell the truth, to help folks uncover their eyes from coats that they have put on and see the truth. Take the coats off and see the truth. Now, another lesson obvious learning from this scripture, from the second scripture, I should say, the gospel lesson,
is that we look at this, or we should, as we did this morning, experience this wonderful story as a group of people who themselves threw off their coats with enthusiasm and with joy. And when we do that, then we're more likely to challenge ourselves and say, why then do we so tightly hold to our coats? Why are we so hesitant to shout with joy? It's almost like I'm doing something naughty. I mean, there were people who said, yeah, I'll take a palm branch, but many people said, no, I'm fine. Give it to that person over there. You know who you were. And so it's like our shouts are scripted and obligatory. We hold on to our dignity like it was more important than our love. And the writer of our Lenten study says these words, that our enthusiasm and joy at Jesus' arrival should overcome any impulse to hold back emotion or resources or hopes of where this living Lord will guide us. That's what the challenge of Palm Sunday is to us. So when we hold tightly to the coats we've been given, and when we do not want to shout with reckless abandon, the loss is largely our own. We prevent ourselves from having a faith that pulls at our hearts and sets our voices free and allows us to dream impossible dreams. The kind of dream that Jesus would have us live. The last subtle message, and you'd need to see this scriptures in a larger context to understand that, is that's something what Paul actually, the Apostle Paul, teaches us. You see, Paul, whenever Paul went into a new community, whether it be Philippi or Corinth or something, he would always go to the synagogue first. He would go to the synagogue because in the synagogue was his people. My people are in there, my tribe, my clan, part of who I am. Jewish people, the firstborn of the children of God. That's how they understood it. They were the firstborn of the children of God. And he would give the gospel lesson. Hey, I have heard about one of ours is the Son of God. And if they received that good news, that gospel, that was wonderful. But if they didn't receive it, then Paul would leave and bring the message to the next born, the last born, the Gentiles. And it set up a bit of a dynamic, a kind of a Joseph and his older brother dynamic. And we see the same thing happening with Jesus. When he walked, he came and he said that, I am God's favored one, the Son of God. And their response was, you, latecomer to the table, you're not even trained rabbi. How can you claim to be the Son of God? You expect us to bow down to you? And like the story of Joseph, the sign of the favored one was ripped and dipped in blood. They thought if they could kill the dreamer, they could kill the dream. Now, it's important for us to understand that context because both that story and the first one I told could easily be seen as anti-Semitic. But our story, our scriptures are not meant to be anti-Semitic. They're meant for us to understand who we are, where we came from, who our family is. And as family, give us the obligation to speak to each other as family. To hold up when it is time to hold up, and to nudge when it is time for people to stop. That's our obligation. It's our obligation as family. It's our obligation to call for peace, to end vengeance. And it will be the dreamers who do that.
Amen. Our next hymn is All Glory, Laud, and Honor, number 122 in the Voices United or on the PowerPoint. Once again, let us pray. My gracious God, you work through ordinary people and choose to tell your salvation story through complicated families. You refuse to give up even when we hurt one another deeply and let the clamor of excitement fade into shouts of crucify him. As we consider our family stories, we see both the beauty and the pain. We know we have loved well, but have also hurt those we love the most. Forgive us. Plant within us the dream of reconciliation, and then give us the courage to follow that dream. Use these seasons of joy and seasons of confusion to bring us all closer to you and tightly bound to each other. In silence, we pray for members of the worldwide family of humanity who need your healing, your forgiving,
and your empowering word. In silence, we reach out to you and to them. And now, as followers of Jesus who seek to live the prayer you taught us, we sing together.
To those who have joined us in the sanctuary today, whether visitor or regular member, thank you for being present and sharing what you can. You are changing lives with your gifts. On the screen are various ways to share. A reminder that Trinity and Forest Hill are working together but are still two separate churches with separate finances. If you are not on par, or not a regular giver with either church, envelopes are provided in the pew so you can choose who receives your offering. The offering plates will now be passed. Oh, sorry, Scott.
That's no worries. Me again. As you know, our theme this month is helping. And members of our council, you can move to the next slide, thanks, Chris. Members of our council have asked for fundraising ideas that will not impact our regular giving. As a reminder from our story a couple of weeks ago, we have a history of creativity and generosity here at Forest Hill. And we've held some very creative and successful fundraisers in the past. And so this is just a little visual reminder of the three that we chose to highlight. We sold 1,000 bundles of cedar shakes at $30 a piece to raise money for a new roof back in our 30th anniversary. We sold asphalt at $2.50 a square foot to help offset the cost of a new driveway and fill some, as I said at the time, child-sized potholes. And we invite local food trucks to operate on our grounds for a donation of 10% of their sales to raise funds for a variety of projects. Our ushers have graciously agreed to help me out today because we're going to do a little brainstorming. This is participation time. So we're going to hand out some idea slips. If you don't have them already, they're going to be bringing them up and handing them out to you. Oh, you have them already? Oh, those cheaters. Wait till I talk to their supervisor. All right. And as you know, with brainstorming, there is no such thing as a silly idea. We want to hear as many different ideas as you have, and we'll take just a few minutes right now. And I have a prize of unbelievable value for those for those who happen to share, have the temerity to share during the service. You can certainly write your idea on the slip. I'll place a box on the table in the foyer to collect slips of idea paper from you, but happy to hear any ideas that any of you might have now. Okay, I love it. I love it. Thank you. Any other ideas? Yes.
I'd like to see us do a trunk garage sale, and we sell spaces for the cars in the parking lot, and we all come with our trunk full of things to sell. And there's no cleanup. What then we want to use, we don't sell anything back home.
Other ideas? Yes.
Love it.
I'd like to see a men's fashion show.
Is that fashion or misfashion? Okay. Is that an idea, John? All right, I think you get the idea. I'm really happy that some people have chosen to share, and I thank you for that. Happy for also to receive your idea slips, anything at all. You don't have to write your name and email address on if you don't want to, but it would be really helpful for us to be able to follow up with you and explore some of the ideas that you have. So thank you again very much.
Thanks, Scott. Now let's stand and sing the doxology from Voices United 951 and follow along on the PowerPoint. The choir is going to sing it through first, and the congregation is asked to join the second time through. Seated. Let us pray. The crowds offered you their coats to walk on. They waved palm branches, honoring your presence. Today we honor you, Lord, with our faithful tithes and offerings. We lay these gifts before you, humble tokens of our love, a public display of affection for our King of Kings. Amen. From the high of Palm Sunday, we know the trials of Holy Week are coming. Not everyone will be able to make it to the Good Friday service at Calvary United this week at 10, so we're going to end our time together peering into the darkness that is to come. Please join in our Holy Week hymn number 133 in Voices United, or follow on the PowerPoint, Go to Dark Gethsemane. Thank you.
slide, please. Passing from joy into sorrow and on to elation, we come to Christ this Holy Week. Today is only a part of the story. Jesus' triumph leads to his death, and his death to his resurrection. May the journey of this week lead you into fullness of Christ's love and fullness of discipleship. Amen. Go with God and go in peace.